for Yah, righteousness, Jerusalem, and the Holy Seed. Peace, everybody, to our national and international audience. Hope everybody's in the greatest health as possible, and everybody's focused in these times of trials and tribulations. Again, as it was written in Daniel chapter 12, right? What did Yah say to Daniel in that 12th chapter, which again, remember, it's the first vision Daniel got, 11:36 to 12:10 Daniel. And he's telling him about, you know, this end time, end of the four dominions of man. And he says it's a time of trouble never been since it's been a nation. I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, can see that. The powers that be, the illuminated ones, what they're doing now is causing, to the best of their ability, divisiveness and chaos. Again, Novo Ordo Chao, New World Order through chaos. You know, as they're racing, trying to set up a fifth dominion of man, which will never be. You know, as we've said here in the past, I'll say it here again, Yah is setting up his dominion, which will be the last dominion on earth, in his kingdom, and the kingdom has always been Yah's and always will be. He gives dominion to whom and whoever he gives it to on earth. Now he's setting up the first dominion, which was his dominion on earth. Again, Micah chapter 4, it's come full circle, and Yah is setting up his dominion, which was the first dominion on earth. Again, which will be the last dominion that will last forever, as we are watching the crumbling and the destruction of this fourth dominion of man, the diversified dominion, Daniel chapter 7, which we see at this very day is diversified, okay? Because you've got Illuminati, Amalekite, Edomites that have dominion in various places of the earth. Again, Russia, China, America, we still see the monarchies still have, you know, power themselves to a great degree, but they don't have the dominion. You know, the monarchies in Western Europe. And again, those are the kings and queens and princes that Yah has spoken of that will come to his movement in the last days of this fourth dominion of man, when Yah brings the judgment on the descendants of Esau, the Edomians that are in Jerusalem and Israel at this very day. And Yah has allowed them to have dominion over his land in Israel, the Zionist movement, and the Edomites that are there. We're waiting on Yah to bring their calamity, their judgment upon them, which is spoken of again in Shai chapter 33, Shai chapter 34. It's even talked about in the 35th chapter, as well as the one chapter of Bajah. But first, again, Yah had to expose them for who and what they are. The robbers, the murderers, the deceivers, as they are called in Ezekiel chapter 7. And this happened in 586 BC at the fall of Jerusalem, when the robbers entered in into Yah's beautiful ornament and defiled it. That was the Edomites then, as it was spoken of in Jeremiah chapter 49 verse 19 and Jeremiah chapter 50 verse 44. They would come up like a lion from the swelling of Jordan to the habitation of the strong. And so now we're waiting for Yah to suddenly make them run away from her. Jerusalem, Israel, and Yah will run them into their borders, where he will judge them and will make them like the burnings of a lion. Yeshaya chapter 33, verse 12, as well as the 34th chapter, Yeshaya. You'll see that there. Their land is to become like burning pitch, molten lava, you know, at the destruction that they have brought upon themselves for all the things that they have done, going all the way back again to 587, 586 at the fall of Jerusalem that Yah talks about in Ezekiel chapter 35, and how at the fall, and again he also talks about it in Ezekiel 7, and when they entered into Yah's beautiful ornament, the temple, and defiled it, the robbers, who again Yah refers to in that same chapter as the Edomites as being the robbers, right? Being the worst of the heathen. Because again, these illuminated Malachite Edomites and possibly other descendants of Esau, Temanites, what have you, they were aware of Yah. They were raised, again, Esau was raised, right? The original Esau was raised in the law of Yah, just like Yaakov, right? Yaakov being, you know, the father of the Israelites, right? They were both raised in the law of Yah. But as it was prophesied to Rebekah, their mother, when they were in Rebekah's womb, in the book of Genesis, right? That the younger would rule over the elder. And so that right there lets, you know, the reader know, us know, and whomever else is reading that, in actuality, that Yah was telling Rebekah that the younger would be about him. The younger would be submissive and committed to obeying Yah's laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts. And the older one would not. That's the essence of that. Because that's the deciding factor, the conditional factor. It has always been from the beginning of this, you know, creation of the earth, everything appointed man being created and by Yah upon the face of the earth. Who is going to obey Yah of hosts, the creator, the king, the fountain of living water, the spirit and creator of all living things? Who's going to obey? Who's going to submit and commit and obey with a willing heart and a willing mind all of Yah's laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts, as we see in Deuteronomy chapter 32, right? When all these things were to come upon the descendants of Israel, first the blessing, then the curse, and those of us who would seek Yah out, wherever we are on the face of the earth, in this captivity, under this curse, double curse, if you're a descendant of Jerusalem, seed or egg of Dawid or Zadok or the Levites, then you've got a double curse on you. And any of the children of Israel that would seek Yah out, once the seal was taken off the book, and we know again, the seal was taken off the book, the seal that's talked about in Daniel chapter 12, again, the first vision Daniel got, after the 2 days or 2,000 years, what you see in Hosea 6, and again in Daniel chapter 12, it was after 2,500 years when, you know, the seal would come off the book, when Daniel got that first vision, okay? 2,500 years later, the seal would come off the book. And again, we know Daniel got that first vision in 604 BCE. And the seal came off the book in 1896 CEAD, 2,500 years later, right? And again, we know that because the following year, 1897 CEAD, is when the House of Rothschild reached out and took the Theodore Herzl movement, the Zionist movement, to the land of Israel, okay? We've talked about this in the past. And again, this was 1897, and that's what, you know, we see fulfilled, the top part of the one chapter of Obadiah, those who eat of thy bread, those who took you to the border, have laid a wound upon you that you cannot perceive. These are the descendants of Esau. And these were the Zionists, those who made up the Zionist movement, and those who have come to the land of Israel over the years since 1897, of the descendants of Esau, and who claim the land of Israel is theirs. Robbers, what they are. Liars, what they are. Perpetrators, what they are. Deceivers, what they are. All descendants of Esau who claim to be Israel. Again, they are Jews. Israelites are not Jews. The descendants of Esau are the Jews, but they're not Israel. It's just that simple. It's not hard to understand that. For those of you out there, whether you Israelite, Hamite, Shemite, Edomite, who really read this book of remembrance and understand what you're reading, okay? There's no way that the descendants of Esau fulfilled the prophecies of Yisrael, who were to return to Yah, and in so doing, would, you know, come to the land of Israel, as we see with the Dimona movement, as what I call them, Sodom and her daughters, Ezekiel 16. Those who come forth out of the waters of Yahuda, Yeshayah chapter 48, the first 9 verses, right? And the 10th verse there, Yah says, how, you know, should his name be polluted, he would not give his glory unto another. Because those of the Dimona movement, or Sodom and her daughters, as they're called in Ezekiel 16, have never been about Yah to this day. They worship a human being, as they did from the basic their beginnings back in the late 60s. And that person they were worshiping, and many of them to this day still worship, Ben-Ami, who is since passed now, over 5 years. That's their idol, main idol, besides whatever other idols, you know, they're into, putting them, you know, themselves before Yah, putting Ben-Ami before Yah, whatever else. Because as I said in the past, when you're in idolatry, you're always idolizing more than one entity. Okay, you're putting more than one entity before Yah. But nevertheless, returned in 68. They started to come back in 68. The bulk of them came over in March of 1970. We know that now. But again, you've had others of the descendants of Israel who have gone to the land. Talked to some who, as I've said in the past, who were to leave and go over there. I don't know if they're still there or not. I know some have left in the last few years and gone to the land. And from what I understand, they, you know, some have not been able to stay there because you get a visa that only lasts for a certain length of time. You know, I hear some have gone down into Egypt, which they should never have done that if they had understood. But nevertheless, you know, that's been done. So, again, you have Israelites who've sought Yah out and have awakened. Because, like, again, the seal came off the book in 1896. And if Yah was looked for, he could be found. We see that, Israelites started to awaken in 1896. William Crowder, we've talked about that in the past. And you've had many since then, and more now. It looks like more and more every day, Israelites across the face of the earth are awakening to the fact that they are Israel. I know that these so-called Palestinians basically the bulk of them, and I do mean the bulk, are descendants of Israel. And I would think so many of them are awakening to the fact that they are Israel and are monitoring this movement, listening to the words that are coming forth from the movement of the Most High, Yah, our righteousness, as it's written of in the Book of Remembrance, like in Zechariah chapter 10, when Yah said, the descendants of the 10 tribes called Ephraim there, or Samaria, would awaken and remember Yah in far countries and turn again. I'm certain that is happening and has been happening. And they're monitoring and they're listening. You had more and more Israelites over the last 100+ years since 1896 have awakened to the fact that Israel, but again, snared, confused. I was just told here the other week, one of the brothers here that whose father just passed at the beginning of this year, January 1st, I think it was, 2021, was called a rabbi. This gentleman who just passed, called himself Rabbi Hodges, didn't understand much of anything. I know that. I had a brief conversation with him, and, a couple, one back in 1991, and another one here a few years ago, but didn't understand much of anything. But I've been told that his one of his sons, James Jr., is now acknowledged the fact that he's confused, and so we'll see how that goes now with him, if he's really ready to acknowledge his misdirection and lack of understanding, and now ready to actually start to build and construct the way of Yah in his heart. It's many who are like that. And when I say that, I'm not saying it disparaging. Anybody that turns to Yah of hosts, I don't care who you are, you have to acknowledge that you didn't know. You have to acknowledge that you were wrong in the way that you were walking. I don't care who you are. Okay, that's one of the first things that has to be acknowledged. Okay, and as in so doing, you acknowledge your iniquity. Okay, not that one is necessarily wicked, just that they were wrong. Okay, like Yah says in Jeremiah chapter 3, only acknowledge that iniquity, right? Not that you're necessarily wicked, right? But again, if you're not about Yah of hosts, your creator, then you're in the paths of iniquity. Simple as that. There are no shades of gray. Wrong or right, black or white, you're either about Yah or you're not. So people have to, again, as we said in the past, discard ego, discard pride, discard arrogance, or what have you, okay, that creates one from being able to illuminate, okay, because it's Yah that gives illumination, Yah that gives wisdom and understanding. Okay, first 9 chapters of Proverbs tells you this, right? And Solomon, who wrote Proverbs, right? From the wisdom and understanding that Yah poured into him, also alludes to this in Ecclesiastes. As he said, that he first dealt in wisdom. He wanted to see, you know, what that was all about. Then he dealt in folly. He wanted to see what that was about. And he tells you that Yah allowed him to retain his wisdom so he could write about it. And as he says, Solomon, in Ecclesiastes, when he dealt in both and he examined them, he saw that wisdom excels folly as far as light excels darkness. And we look at the world today. Honestly, logically, truthfully, we see the turmoil, the chaos, the confusion, the darkness that people are steeped in from the things that they do. I mean, it's, you know, it's really horrible. Okay? What man has done on the face of this earth through the centuries, and now we see, you know, what it's culminating in, and it's total darkness. I mean, you know, it's just so much destruction and chaos and just inaneness, foolishness, you know, that goes on constantly across the face of the earth. I mean, there's no place on earth where, you know, foolishness and darkness does not, you know, exist, okay, and is prevalent. Now is the time, again, Yah is setting up his dominion, the last dominion on earth. This is why we see, as Yah said in the 42nd chapter of Yeshaya, you know, he had held his peace for a long time, okay, because again, the seal was on the book for, you know, again, you know, Hosea chapter 6, for 2 days, okay, 2,000 years. The book was sealed where it couldn't be understood by any Israelite, okay, and as well as any Israelite couldn't understand it. Most people in the earth, and I do mean most, could not understand it. But you've always, you know, again, since 536 BCE, Daniel chapter 9, verse 24, when Yah brought in the everlasting righteousness and to anoint himself as the most holy, you would always have people on the earth from that point on that knew unequivocally that Yah was the creator. Now, it was very few, but through the years and through the centuries, you've had knowledgeable people, people of stature, educated, if you will, who came to understand that Yah was he who creates. And you've got many people today of nations who know that Yah is the Most High and know that the captives, captive slaves, if you will, blacks, African Americans here, as we're called, colored here in America, throughout the islands, in Europe, in Asia, in various places of the earth, they know we're the descendants of Israel. You've got so many people who understand that unequivocally. I mean, that's the only answer for what has happened to Israel all the way to this very day. When we look and examine the plight of Israelites, of, you know, the descendants of Israel, where we've been scattered, and even in the land of Israel to this day, the so-called Palestinians, Israelites, okay? And again, you've got that Dimona movement, as I call it, the Sodom and Adorda movement, that's been in the land over 50 years, Israelites, right? You've got other Israelites that are there, right? Again, who have gone back to the land, but again, you know, they are confused. I say that unequivocally with no apprehensions, because of those, you've got some in the land of Israel who have gone back in the last few years that used to be plugged into Yah righteousness. But Yah purged them out a few years ago. They left on their own accord and got ahead of Yah. Okay? As we've spoken of, you know, for whatever their reasons. And those who have been listening to Yah righteousness, and those who have been reading and really studying and applying themselves to keeping the laws, statutes, orders, judgments, commandments, and precepts of Yah, understand or should understand that you don't get ahead of Yah. Okay? And as I've been saying now for some years, Yah leads his movement to Jerusalem. And that's expressed explicitly in the 52nd chapter of Yeshaya. It's also expressed in the 33rd chapter of Yeshaya that the Jerusalem movement, those who make up Yah's arm, who he brings back through the elite of the earth, would not return or be brought to Yisrael and Jerusalem before Yah judged the descendants of Esau. Okay, as it says in the 33rd chapter of Yeshaya, we would not see a people of a fierce countenance, a people of a deeper speech, a stammering tongue than we could perceive or understand. Been saying that now for years. But again, you've had some, because of whatever's in their heart, who heard this, some exhibited to me that they understood, but they must not have understood it because they've gone before Yah. Okay? They've gone to the land and evidently weren't able to stay in the land. That's why some of them went down into Egypt or came back here or wherever they went. Again, you know, the land of Israel is the land that Yah has given to the children of Israel. But you're not going to be able to stay there, okay, and truly prosper until you are totally committed and submitted to Yah. Now, again, he's brought back the Sodom and her daughter movement, as he said he would, and as he talked about those who come forth out of the waters of Yahudah, who stay themselves upon the strong of Israel. Yah of hosts is his name, but not in truth nor in righteousness. Yah says there in that 48th chapter of Yeshaya, in verse 9, that he would refrain for them, even though they're in idolatry, all these over 50 plus years, he would refrain for them that he cut them not off. Okay? That's why he's been able to, you know, he's kept them in the land. That's why they're still there to this day. That's why they'll be there when Yah returns to the land of Israel on the head of his arm, the Jerusalem movement, and his glory at our rearward. You know, him at our rearward, right? Again, Yeshaya chapter 52. And the whole world shall see when Yah brings again Zion. Because this in actuality will be the anointing of Yah of hosts as he who creates in the sight of everyone on the face of the earth. See? And that's when Yah will make himself known, Ezekiel chapter 35, amongst his people. Even though they, you know, Israelites, wherever they are on the face of the earth, he'll make himself known to them. But you'll still have very few descendants of Israel who will truly understand what they're watching. Just like you've got very few people today on the face of this earth who knows and understands what actually is going on right before their eyes now. Okay? Because again, we're watching the systematic destruction of the fourth dominion of man, and with the destruction of the fourth dominion of man, those, you know, first three dominions of man, right? Babylonian, Medo-Persian, and Greek dominions that rest upon this fourth dominion, the diversified dominion, are crumbling as well. You know, they're all going out. Because again, none of those four dominions of man can transition over into the dominion of Yah. Only human beings, no ideologies, no concepts, no inventions, okay, from those four dominions of man can transition over into the dominion of Yah. Only human beings. And those are the human beings that seek Yah out, submit with a whole heart and soul, and become compliant, totally compliant with all of Yah's law. Again, Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 2. It's always been conditional, always will be. You have to obey Yah with all your heart and soul. You have to totally commit and submit. There is no equivocation there. Again, there are no shades of gray. Black and white, wrong or right, you're either one or the other. And that's why, again, you know, this Jerusalem movement, as it says in Yeshaya chapter 27, has been going through refinement, right? Again, what do you see in Yeshaya 27? The Leviathan in the sea, okay? That's the illuminated Edomite that controls this daughter of Babylon through the Skull and Bone Boys, right? This United States of America, and the illuminated Edomite, that the same illuminated Edomite that controls the land of Israel, right? That took, okay, the Zionist movement to the border, you know, the family, the house of Rothschild. And I know it's other, you know, illuminated Amalekite Edomites that were compliant with that, you know, in harmony with that move, okay? But it, what does it say in 27th chapter Yeshaya? When, as it's, the Jerusalem movement is called the Vineyard of Red Wine in that chapter. And when it first shot forth, what does it say? The Leviathan, the great snake, would debate with it. He didn't want to believe it when he saw it. He was looking for it. He knew it was coming. See? And he knew what it was to be called. Again, you remember chapter 23, right? Yeah, our righteousness. But he didn't want to believe it when it first shot forth, the Leviathan. And what did Yah say there? By this, therefore, shall the iniquity of Zion, not Yaakov, right? Zion, Jerusalem, be purged, because we're in refinement. Okay, as I said to some, and I think I said here the other month, or last year, their year, you know, as Solomon says, nothing new up under the sun, right? So when you go back to 1 Samuel, right, chapter 18, you see when David, after he had killed Goliath, David raised in the law of Yah. David was built up by Yah, refined by Yah to a certain degree from when he killed the lion, killed the bear, and then he killed Goliath, right? And he was made captain of the host by Saul, right? So 1 Samuel chapter 18, you know, all of the army, right, of Israel, they watched David. They saw how he dealt wisely. And one is only deals wisely when they're in harmony with the law, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts of their creator, Yah of hosts. Okay, that's what determines if one is dealing wisely or not. And then later on in first book Samuel, chapter 18, you go down a little bit further, you see that Saul, and by that time, you know, the word had got to him that Yah had David anointed by Samuel, right? And Saul tried to do something, tried to get David to do something that was out of harmony with the law. And David wouldn't bite. Okay, he didn't respect persons in judgment. He didn't respect Saul. And when I say that, didn't respect persons in judgment, right? Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 17. Right? We're not supposed to respect persons in judgment. And the judgment is whose? The judgment is Yah's. And that's the law, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts of Yah. And so when Saul saw that, you understand, David didn't respect him in judgment. And he saw that, as it says there, that David behaved himself very wisely, right? Then he feared David, right? Then he started trying to have David killed. Tried to kill him himself a couple of times, right? And then it got to the point where David had to flee. And so now, when David fled, right? And when you get to 1 Samuel chapter 22, what does it say? When he fled and went to the cave of Adullam, and his brothers heard of it, okay? Then you had 400 of the army of Israel that figured it out, that came to understand the reason why we are in distress, the reason why we are discontented, the reason why we are in debt, is because we are not in harmony with Yah's laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts, of which they understood, right? Here in 1 Samuel chapter 18 at the top, that David was in harmony with Yah's laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts, and they figured it, you know, the word got to them that David had been anointed by Samuel. By Yah. See? So they left from Saul, who was adversarial to Yah, right? And they had been adversarial to Yah. That's why they were discontented, in debt, and distressed. Sound familiar? Sound like today? Pardon. Okay, so they went over to David. By going over to David, it was like going over to Yah. Was it not? Because David was Yah's anointed. And then a little later, 200 more figured it out. And they went over to David, which was again going over to Yah. And then we see, you could, like, I, you know, it's kind of hard to figure out how long they went, you know, how much time passed during their preparation, their refinement. But it looks like around maybe about 9 years, you know, somewhere around there. Pardon me. And, when you get to 1 Samuel chapter 30, the situation with the Amalekites who had raided their camp when they were gone, took their wives and children, didn't take anything of value, you know, materialistically, because they didn't have anything of value materialistically. You know, they had been impoverished over those like 9 years, David and his men. We can see that, right? And so the Amalekites had raided the camp, took the wives and children. And when David and his men returned, they were very grieved at the situation, right? What does it say? Some of David's own men wanted to kill him, right? But it says that David encouraged himself in Yah, and some kind of way, doesn't say how, Yah made it known to David that if he pursued this group of, you know, of raiders, they would recover their children and their wives. And so they pursued after, came upon the Egyptian who had been discarded by the Amalekite Edomites, right? And left behind because he was sickly. And, you know, when they came upon him, David talked to him, and the Egyptian revealed that he could bring them down on this company of Amalekites. His main thing was, just don't turn me back over to him, okay? And we see that when David and his men, you know, pursued the Amalekites and came upon them when the sun had gone down, and attacked them when the sun went down until the evening of the next day. Again, when it got dark, the skirmish was over. So the skirmish went from anywhere from like 30 to 55 minutes, you know, all depending on whether it was cloudy or not, the sun shining, right? And when the skirmish was over, David and his men had recovered all, not only their wives and children, but all of the spoil that had been accumulated by these Amalekite Edomites, right, as they had been raiding towns, villages, encampments of others over a period of time and had acquired all this wealth. And when they, had defeated them and the Amalekites had succumbed to David and his men, then David says, this is my spoil, right? And we see that he sent presents to the different groups of people who had aided him and his men through the years. But we also see, because in their pursuit of the Amalekite Edomites, 200 of the 600 men of David became faint. And so, they left those 200 in a particular place and left some of their gear, what have you, their substance with them and said, well, you stay here and we'll go on. And then when the 400, vanquished the Amalekites, and then they returned to the 200 who stayed by the stuff, as it says, right? The 400 that went with David, you understand, still in their refinement, you understand, still hadn't risen to the understanding that you don't do wickedness to your brethren, right? You share and share alike. They didn't want to share with the 200 that stayed by the stuff, but David negated that and said, no, we're not going to do that. And that became a law to this day, right? Where David said, we part alike. You understand? And they shared with the 200 that stayed by the stuff, okay? But it was a great spoil. And the point in that is from that point on, we see that David and those who had come over to David had gone through a certain amount of refinement, preparation, humbleness, and understanding that had been acquired, illumination, okay, and humility, that now Yah started to bless them with materialism. Okay? Where they had been discontented, in distress, and indebted. Okay? That, like I said, went on for a while because they had to go through refinement. Nothing new up under the sun. So again, when we look at Yeshaya chapter 27, and Yah is talking about the Jerusalem movement, the vineyard of red wine, when it first appeared, when it first popped up, when it was first established, the illuminated Edomites saw it, the Leviathan, the great snake, right? He didn't want to believe it. As Yah says in that 27th chapter of Yeshaya, he stays his rough wind in the day of the east wind. By this, therefore, shall the iniquity of Zion, Jerusalem, be purged. And again, during that 9 years, not only were the 400 to 600 men being and their families being refined, okay, and iniquity and adversity being purged out of them, okay, David was being refined as well. Even though he was about the law, he still was in refinement himself, okay? So now when we see Yah started to bless them materialistically and in the time of impoverishment, when you go over into 2 Samuel, it's not long before all Israel came over to David, and then coming over to David, they came over to Yah. See? Because as we see in Yeshaya chapter 11, what did Yah say? I'll read it to you verbatim. And you'll see the similar thing, again, happened with David, right? And this is Yeshaya chapter 11 at the top. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. That's talking about today, okay? and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the spirit of Yah shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of Yah, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of Yah. And he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness, in other words, the statutes, laws, ordinances, judge, commandments, and precepts of Yah of hosts, shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins. Now, again, this is what, you know, is happening as I speak, and been happening, right? And you'll see as you keep reading, right? Once the movement of Yah is brought to the Holy Mount, you know, again, once we go through that attack of the Assyrians, right? Micah chapter 5, Zechariah chapter 12, and chapter 13, right? Then Jerusalem and the land starts to become holy, the land of Israel. It starts in Jerusalem, because again, Jerusalem has to be cleansed of all idolatry. And that's what you've got there today, and have had for centuries, okay, millennia now. Idolatry, because that's what got Israel brought under the curse, and Jerusalem, the descendants of Jerusalem, brought under the double curse, is it not? For our forefathers' iniquity. See? And the iniquity that, again, we've been raised in this captivity, right? Because, again, we roots out of dry ground, Yeshayah chapter 53, right? That's why, as I've said before, if one really understands Yeshayah chapter 42, chapter 49, and chapter 53, there is no way that could be talking about the main idol of Christianity. Okay, because it's talking about someone who didn't know who he was, didn't know anything about the Creator, didn't know anything about the Creator's law, Yahweh's laws, okay, from birth. See, root out of dry ground. And again, this is, you know, put forth explicitly in the 42nd chapter, 49th chapter, 53rd chapter of Yeshayah. Okay? And now, as you get to verse 10 in chapter 11, Yeshayah, what does it say? And in that day, there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign, a sign, right, of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious, right? And it shall come to pass. Now it goes on to talk about the second gathering. So all this comes about before the second gathering, right? Because again, when the second gathering takes place, the Jerusalem would have been cleansed of all idolatry. The temple of Yah would have been built. The sacrifices on, evening and morning, like clockwork. Okay? You know, because here the last month or so, you know, I've had calls, again, you know, new callers. A person called, you know, he came at me from a position of, he said, told me initially he didn't, he just had come into the knowledge of this movement. This is about a month ago, not quite. He wasn't knowledgeable of this movement. And, you know, he called, we talked, told me he had been raised as a priest. But at the same time, he told me he's vegan. Basically, you know, he doesn't eat meat. And also, he didn't, agree with the eating of meat. As the conversations unfolded over a period of a few weeks, he said to me, basically, he had been raised in the teachings of Ben Ami. And then he also, as the conversations ensued, revealed to me that he looked at possibly that the temple and those things in the book about offerings and sacrifices possibly were inserted in this book of remembrance by the adversary, okay, or the adversaries, the sense of Esau. He didn't say it like that, but that's what he alluded to, right? But as I said to him, when it over a period, like I said, a few weeks, the conversation, progressed to this point, and he eventually revealed that to me. And I said to him, I said, here we go. I said, now, yes, then you get people who want to remove things out of this book. He didn't say it just like this, but he indicated per se that, that he's heard me say things that, we see in this book have been, different things have been added or taken away, right? And I said to him, I said, my man, if you took everything out of this book that's dealing with the temple of Yah and the offerings and the sacrifices, okay, you wouldn't have much book left. It's just that simple. You wouldn't have much book left, okay? Because, just like, for instance, Yeshaya chapter 66, Yah says, the heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool, where is the house you build unto me, and where is the place of my rest? Okay? See what I'm saying? This person said to me, because at one point, as he, over a period of time, like I said, in the conversations, ensued, he revealed to me, he was like into the teachings of Ben Ami and whatnot. He had been raised as a priest, but he said he couldn't see killing animals, and he really doesn't, because like he's a vegan. He doesn't need to, he intimated he doesn't eat flesh, right? He might not necessarily be a vegan, but he doesn't eat flesh, right? And he said at one point, you can't. I said, he said you're eating blood when you eat flesh, and I'm like, cook the blood out, and he was like, well, you can't cook it out. And I said, well, then you're saying that our forefathers ate blood, and we can see many times where they ate flesh. I said, so you're saying they ate blood? Again, every time they did the Passover, you're saying that the blood can't be cooked out, so they ate blood? And that's not what's indicated in the book, in the times when they were in harmony with Yah, right? He had no answer for that. But also he said he had been raised a priest, but he didn't really have the spirit like to be a priest. And it was like he wasn't in harmony with offerings and sacrifices. And I said, more likely than not, my man, the reason why that is because you're not of the seed of Lawai. You're not of the seed of Zadok. You very well could be of the seed of Yahuda Benjamin. As I said before, nobody knows of the children of Israel what line they're, what tribe they're out of, per se. They can guess, but it can't be guesswork. Got to know, right? The only one actually knows is the seed of David that Yah's working through, that he's worked through to establish his movement. And like I said, the only reason he knows is because what Yah is doing through him. Everybody else got to wait on Yah to reveal what tribe they're from. Okay, and who's a priest, who's a Levite, what have you, right? Who's the high priest, right? You got to wait on Yah for that. So again, this person here, a couple weeks back, last time he called, a little over 2 weeks ago now, he says to me, he said, well, bro, I got this book I think, you know, be beneficial for you to read. He told me, I said, what's the name of it? He told me, I don't remember what the name of it was, but I said, who wrote it? And when he told me the name, I said, that's an Edomite, isn't it? Sounds like an Edomite to me. Okay? I says, it makes all the sense in the world to me that an Edomite would write something that would negate the temple of Yah and the sacrifices and offerings of Yah. Because his whole thing is to deter us, to take us away from Yah, to put obstacles, blocks in front of us. He really didn't have anything to say to that either. I haven't heard from him since. And I also said to him, because what he said to me when he first, first time or two he called, a few weeks prior to that, that he had been listening to, things that has come through this movement, and he said it was very enlightening and this and that. So I brought that back to him, in the last conversation. The illumination that Yah has given through this movement, do you think he would have given it if we were not in harmony with him? If we were eating blood, committing iniquity and wickedness, in the extent of being, recalcitrant, stiff-necked, obstinate, picking and choosing of what we're going to do of Yah's laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts. You think Yah would give the illumination that he's given through this movement over the years if we were that way? He had no answer for that. Because I told him, I said, that's why we're on the phone, isn't it? Because you told me the illumination you had gotten, things that, and even in the conversations that we had over the previous, like 2.5-3 weeks, he said, things that he's, oh man, I didn't, told me a couple times, I didn't look at it from that perspective, man. You know what I mean? Some things hit him. So I'm like, why would Yah give the illumination that he's given and still gives and pray always will continue to give, to this movement that is called by his name and predicated on his laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts, his righteousness. Because again, this is why Yah has purged different ones away from this movement because of what's in their heart. Okay? Because of what they were doing or weren't doing or both. Because again, as I've said, when you look at that Ezekiel chapter 16:59-63, right? And he talks about the descendants of Jerusalem who eventually despised the oath that, Dawid, Zadok, the priesthood, the Levites had entered in with Yah, right? That special oath and covenant that's talked about in Ezekiel chapter 16:59-63. And eventually, the progenitors, their descendants, got to the point where they hated the oath and the covenant that, their forefathers had entered in with Yah, and Yah had entered in with them. And they broke it. So Yah is saying there in Ezekiel 16:59-63, that's not going to happen ever again. That's why he purged so many away from this movement a few years ago when, you know, I thought we were coming out and y'all did, and it didn't happen, right? And then you had different ones who, you know, some wanted to kill me, put up out on the internet. I was told, you know, I'm supposed to die. You know, I'm a false prophet, right? All these type of things. And so many left from this movement. And then y'all revealed to me, you know, as we went on, that was, you know, again, you shot chapter 49. You know, Yerushalayim said, y'all done forgot us. He's forgotten. You know, he's forsaken. And what did y'all say? I haven't forgotten you. I haven't forsaken you. Right? And never will. Right? You know, like he makes the, you know, analogy, you know, like you can't a woman, you know, a mother forget the child of her womb. They may forget, but I shall not forget thee. Thy walls are engraven upon the palms of my hand and are continually before me. Right? And then, you know, Ezekiel 16:59-63, he's not going to allow anybody to be with the Jerusalem movement, be part of it, that's not totally committed and submitted to him. Anybody that's got a secret agenda, anybody that thinks it's about them, anybody that wants to be exalted themselves, okay, or anybody that doesn't have enough faith, okay, weak-minded, any liars, deceivers, he's not going to allow them to be part of his army, the Jerusalem movement, and return with him on his return to Jerusalem in the sight of everybody on the earth. Again, at his anointing. Just like he anointed himself when he brought the children of Israel, our forefathers, out of Egypt. Right? When he anointed himself, as it so states, right, in 536 BCE, when he raised up Cyrus, right? Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. That was the anointing of Yah. And he's anointed himself, you know, times before, right? Back in 704-05 BCE, when he killed 185,000 Assyrians overnight, he anointed himself, which is talked about he was going to do the back end of chapter 10, Yeshua. Okay? You know, matter of fact, I'm right here now. I'll read you what I'm talking about. I pick it up in verse 24, chapter 10, Yeshaya. Therefore, thus saith the Lord Yah of hosts, O my people that dwells in Zion, be not afraid of the Assyrian. This is, you know, back in 705, 704 BCE. He shall smite thee with a rod, and shall lift up his staff against thee after the manner of Egypt. For yet a very little while, and the indignation shall cease, and my anger and their destruction. And Yah of hosts shall stir up a scourge for him according to the daughter, a slaughter of Midian at the rock of Oreb. And as his rod was upon the sea, so shall he lift it up after the manner of Egypt. And it shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken away from off thy shoulder, and his yoke from off thy neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. That's what Yah did when he killed 185,000 Assyrians overnight. Back there, like I said, during the time of Sennacherib, he anointed himself. And so now, you know, Yah's getting ready to anoint himself again. Okay? I mean, he anointed himself when the situation Nebuchadnezzar's first dream, right? That Yah brought the second vision to Daniel, that Daniel, you know, he gave Daniel about the dream and the interpretation, right? And Daniel, you know, declared to Nebuchadnezzar, right? Yah of hosts is he who creates. He, you know, Nebuchadnezzar still didn't get it yet. Like I've said, you know, in the past, you know, it took three things for Nebuchadnezzar to be totally humbled, right? The situation with Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Right? Yah anointed himself at that time, but not, you know, by protecting them and not allowing them to be burned up in the fire because they wouldn't, you know, bow down and worship an idol of him or him. You know what I'm saying? Yah anointed himself there, right? And then Yah anointed himself again, right? The third time on Nebuchadnezzar. But this was just Nebuchadnezzar per se, even though Nebuchadnezzar wrote the letter that we see in Daniel chapter 4 about that situation and how after Yah brought that 7 years of, you know, where he was like a beast and driven away and then brought his understanding back to him at the end of 7 years to the day, then Nebuchadnezzar understood that Yah and Yah alone was the creator. There were no others. But that's all that it took to humble him. Okay? Because, you know, he was filled with arrogance and pride, right? And egotism. Like Amenophis II. What did Yah say over there in, what's that, Exodus chapter 9? For in this cause have I raised thee up. I think it's 9, right? When, you know, Yah is talking through Moshe to Amenophis II, right? Right, chapter 9, verse 16, right? So, you know, Yah is getting ready to anoint himself again. See, when he drives out these Edomites all of a sudden into their land, these Edomites that are over there claiming to be Israel. They are Jews, but they're not Israel, right? Because Israelites are not Jews. You got many Israelites who are confused. They think they're Jews, okay? But then in actuality, they're in the synagogue of Satan with that Christianity or Judaism, okay? But that's what we're waiting on, you know, for Yah to suddenly drive the descendants of Esau from Jerusalem and Israel into their border south of the Dead Sea and make them like the burnings of lion through this, the fire that Yah brings through the house of David today, right? The one chapter of Obadiah, okay? Not the house of Jacob, the house of David for fire. That's this word, right? This, you know, the word is fire. Again, we destroy the wicked with the breath of our lips. That's the truth, right? Yah's righteousness and his truth. And he makes the house of Yahosef, descendants out of Ephraim and Manasseh, the flame. And again, Zechariah chapter 10, they know they've started to remember Yah in far countries and starting to turn again, right? And we'll say, what if I have to do with idols? You know, this Christianity or Islam or Judaism or whatever they might be caught up into. Okay. And it's going to make the house of Esau for stubble and they shall kindle in them. And that's what we're waiting on. It's going to happen. It's just a matter of when. It's not if, it's just when. Okay. And again, Yah's been preparing, refining the vineyard of red wine, Yeshaya 27, right? Shad chapter 41, making you understand the vineyard of red wine and those who will make it up and those who make it up, right? New sharp threshing instruments, having teeth, to smite the earth with the rod of our mouth, slay the wicked with the breath of our lips, Shad chapter 11. See, to purge ourselves, again, Jeremiah chapter 10, of the ways of the heathen that we were raised in, right? Whatever those ways were and are, right? And the only way to be able to discern the way of the heathen adverse to the way of Yah, you've got to read this book of remembrance. Read, study, pray, and do. Read, study, pray, and do. Read, study, pray, and do. And in that turning, and eventually you turn 180 degrees, submission, commitment back to Yah, then you take on the attributes, all the ways of his righteousness, his law. All right, and because now you get to the point where you can see what's incompatible with Yah of hosts, Yah of righteousness, the king. Right, what does Solomon say in Proverbs? Put perverse lips far from thee, profane, perverse lips, and eventually those thoughts come with it, or should I say, go with that, right? You start to purge yourself, and eventually, the longer that you're in total submission and commitment to Yah, right? With all your heart and soul, and you take on the ways of Yah, you embrace them, okay? It's not a burden to you. It's not a hardship, right? You know, as I said to many in the past and to all of you at one time or another, you know, quite naturally, it's some things that is easier for you to let go of, and some things it's harder for you to let go of. All, you know, in relationship to one's, you know, affinity to whatever it is of the ways of the heathen. You know, it varies from person to person. One becomes snared and, you know, develops an habitual taste for something that is incompatible with Yah, that's not in harmony with Yah. But even, you know, again, you purge yourself of those things. You follow me? You put those things away, and eventually the taste that you had for them sours, and because you understand this is not conducive, right? It's not conducive for me. It's not conducive for my growth. It's not conducive for my ability to illuminate, for Yah to give me illumination, okay? And strengthening my heart in Yah, my resolve in Yah, and putting away, you know, the worthless things that I had developed a taste for, an affinity for. So this is the process of refinement. Again, it's nothing new. As I said, you know, a little while ago, David and his men went through it. You know, Abraham went through it, right? Because the way it looks, Abraham wasn't raised in the way of Yah. So again, as this refinement has been going on, right? Yah refining his movement, his arm, and all who come up under his banner, into his way, you know, and give themselves to Yah, and Yah is preparing night and day for his purpose. Because all we can ever be, all of us, any of us, is servants to Yah. Whether you're Hamite, Shemite, Yefite, Israelite, Edomite, all you can be is a servant to Yah, or not. You're either going to be a servant to Yah, or you're going to be adversarial. And Yah is in the process of removing the adversaries from the face of the earth, all who's adversarial to him. That's what we're bearing witness to. So again, you know, you see all of this chaos, confusion going on, and the illuminated Edomites, you know, their whole thing is to perpetrate and to inflame the confusion, the divisiveness. You follow me? The chaos. So those of us who are totally committed and submitted to Yah, you know, we plug into Yah, we stay with Yah. As time goes by, we become even more, those of us who are totally committed and submitted, we become even more comfortable as time goes by. Okay? It's like we strapped in for this ride, this journey. And though the journey gets bumpy sometimes, we're strapped in with Yah. Okay? Because he's the orchestrator, we understand that. He's the pilot. He runs the show. Okay? And at times, you know, you make a mistake. Any of us do at times. But we go to Yah and offer up the cares of our lips, Hosea 4:10. Right? We turn toward Jerusalem. Right? And we pray and ask Yah's forgiveness. Right? The cares of our lips. Right? Again, Solomon's supplication. 1 Kings 8, 2 Chronicles chapter 6. We ask for Yah's forgiveness. And we do our best to put away, you know, sins and indiscretions, you know, iniquity, trespass. And I can testify that over a period of time, you know, you pray for focus, you pray for strength. And you never underestimate the power of prayer, but you're praying to He who creates. You're not praying to idols and images or concepts that emanate from the heart of men or man. And Yah gives you strength. He strengthens you. And, you know, brings on you a resolve, a calm in that understanding. But as it says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but Yah brings them through them all. Because I know for myself, you know, it's afflictions every day. I can look out the window, you know, my soul is afflicted at what I see that goes on, what I hear. But again, you know, we give it to the Most High and we do what we need to do in righteousness and in harmony with Yah. And we fear Yah and Yah alone. Because Yah, when we're totally committed and submitted with all our heart and soul, and we become perfect in our heart with Yah, where we, you know, Yah's first, consistently, continuously, He's first. Yeah. Our heart, our mind go to Yah. Whatever happens goes to Yah, whether it's good or evil. See? Because we're in refinement. And we have to, you know, put all our faith, trust, and confidence in Yah. That helmet of salvation we put on, Yeshua chapter 59, right? Unequivocal, unshakable faith in Yah of hosts. And he starts to, as he said to Jeremiah, chapter 18, like the clay was in the hand of the potter, he starts to break us down and, you know, like the diamonds in the hand of the jeweler, right? And the jeweler starts to, you know, clean it up, right? And remove the defects, aberrations, inclusions. Starts to shape and mold us into what He wants us to be. Because, again, all I've ever wanted to be was a servant to Yah of hosts. Simple as that. Be one of His servants. To perform whatever function, play whatever role that I have to play to further Yah's way, to establish Yah's way, to magnify Yah of hosts, to get Him the honor, the praise, the glory that's due Him. Because in His glory, I glory, we glory, all who's totally committed and submitted to Him. So again, this is February the 3rd. I think I said that earlier, right? 2021. You know, it's all kind of things going on, right? I'm going to get into these newspaper articles in a minute. And I know plenty of you have been watching and seeing all these different things that's been happening, right? You have the elitist, you know, committing fraud and all, you know, all kind of corruption going on, you know, trying to, you know, steal and acquire as much economic, you know, financial economics and stability that they can, you know, by lying and deceiving the masses, you know, the poor. You got, you know, people who trying to, you know, make it from day to day, okay, because inflation has begun, you know, big time. I mean, it's starting to go, you know, to rise, okay, and they're just printing more and more paper. Yadita sent us last week, this past weekend, you know, this, she'll probably put it up on the screen where you can go look at it. I mean, you know, this Joe Obama, they call him, right? Basically, you know, Obama's, you know, his cabinet and people who were with him in his 8 years is basically who Biden's got with him to a great degree, right? But she said a thing where like 10 of Joe Biden's top cabinet members are all Edomites. Okay? You know, Janet Yellen is Blinken, and, you know, but 10 of his cabinet members are all Edomites in these authoritative positions. Because when she sent it out, I'm like, yeah, I thought about, you know, as I said last year, pretty sure reading The Internationalist, you know, the Ford by Henry Ford and the Protocols. And what Henry Ford said back in 1920, how is it that a people that only represent 3.8% of the population are in all the authoritative positions in government and other industries and whatnot? You know what I'm saying? How is that? You know, they only make up like 3.8% of the population, but they're in all these authoritative positions. Okay, as I was, you know, telling some people, and matter of fact, you know, Yada and I were talking earlier, you know, this book, Home Records, that I mentioned, I think last session, again, you know, this Aaron Glantz, and he talks about, you know, all of these different financial programs, you know, for the poor that's supposed to be administered, you know, through these banks, right? Where the poor can come in, first-time home buyers, you know, and take advantage of these different government programs. But as he talks about in various places in this book, Home Records, right? No African-American, black, you know, Latino, black and brown people, we don't get those loans. We don't get to be able to access these, you know, privileges and you know, different plans and whatnot that's put forth for the poor to take advantage of to try to strengthen their economic position. You follow me? But the Caucasians and the Edomites, and you know, when Aaron Glantz talks about it, he don't separate the Edomites, you know, or the Jews from the Caucasians. He just say whites. Yeah, that would be. So you know that includes the Edomites in with that group, right? They can take advantage of all these different, you know, plans and whatnot and things that have been set up, you know, supposedly to aid and abet the poor, the impoverished, so that they can acquire some wealth, you know, and like I say, strengthen their economic position, see. But we're locked out. The black and brown, so-called quote-unquote black and brown people. And like I said, he's going back, you know what I'm saying? You know, 30, 40, 50 years ago. And, you know, it's always been that way, but that's the curse on Israel, is it not? You follow what I'm saying? I mean, that's the only answer, okay? Because it's been systematically done through the years, through the, you know, the decades, through the centuries, I mean, because we're under the curse. See, because many of your Latino, you know, brethren are Israelites too. I ain't saying all, but many of them are. You know, because we come in all flavors, sizes, colors, and disguises. You know, I mean, because we were colonized by, you know, we've been colonized by many people. People of melanated, you know, darker hue, right? Hamites, right? The Edomites, you know, colonized us, the Ishmaelites, huh? Okay, and quite naturally, descendants of Japheth colonized us, right? The Dutch, the Portuguese, the French, the Spanish, the English, right? And again, Esau, the descendants of Esau, were in every one of those colonizing nations, right? You understand? Led those colonizing expeditions, okay? And again, they started way back there, like we said in the past, Amos chapter 1, Yoel chapter 3, and 83rd Psalm. Okay, see, so again, the only answer is the curse that's on us, right? You know, they call it racism, which you could say that. I mean, we discriminated against in every way. See, but that's the curse. It's the only answer. See, and again, when I say the only answer for the things that have befallen us and the things that have happened to us through the centuries, and definitely over the last 100 plus years, right, 120, 25 years, right? Again, the curse. Like I say, the seal came off the book 125 years ago, right? But because, you know, basically Israel, they weren't looking for Yah, so they didn't find him, right? The ones of us who have sought Yah out, because we were looking for one or two or three or a combination of all those things that will lead you to Yah, you know, peace, truth, righteousness, equity, salvation, looking for the true and living creator. If you're looking for any one of those things with all your heart and soul, at some point you're going to hear about, you know, this book. If you're an Israelite, you know, you're going to hear about this book, or you're going to get in your mind to read it. You know, like me, I was like, got in it to negate it. You know, I was thinking it's all talking about Jesus. You understand? And I, like I said in the past, back then in the late 60s, I wasn't going for no quote-unquote white boy with no blonde hair and blue eyes. You understand? You're going to tell me, and blonde hair hanging down to his shoulders, you're going to tell me he God. I wasn't going for that. That was my mind back in the late 60s. But again, I said to myself, the only way I can really, you know for surety, I got to read this book and bust it out. Once I read the this Bible, nobody better not say anything to me about the Bible, because I could tell them I read it, it's a bunch of nonsense. Well, I eventually got into this Bible, right? And again, you read any book from the beginning, and as I was going through, you know, Genesis through Malachi, you know, I come to find out that this, you know, blonde-haired, so-called blonde-haired white boy, blue eyes, was nothing but idolatry. Okay, not only was he idolatry, it's just totally a figment of one's imagination, you know, totally mythology. Okay, but then also I found out, you know, who I am, what I am, where I come from, me and my people, who we really are, why we are catching all of the problems and you know, the discrimination and racism and the oppression, and systemic racism and oppression and abuse, you know, come to find out why that is, you know, suffering, you know, habitual impoverishment, okay? You know, always struggling because we're always in distress, because we're always discontented, because we're in debt. And I came to realize why, because we're under a curse. Why? Because we descendants of Israel has nothing to do with pigmentation and melanation. See, and in so doing, finding that out, I came to understand, you know, what was needed to bring an end to my distress, my discontentment, my indebtedness, or the lack of economics, And again, most people think that, the monetary end, the money, whether it's gold or silver, the real money, or the, the fictitious, money, the paper, the dollars, the euros, that most people think, quote unquote, money is the answer to all things. As we said before, Esau had to put that over in Proverbs, or is it in Ecclesiastes where it says money answers all things? That's not true. See, that had to be inserted by the illuminated Edomite, because money does not answer all things. Okay? Because wisdom is the principal thing. And if you don't have wisdom, which begins with the fear of Yah, right? And then what does it say? So therefore, get wisdom, but with all thy getting, get understanding, get knowledge, because that's what understanding is, knowledge, right? And if you don't have any wisdom, then you're in trouble, right? And if you don't have any knowledge, you're in double trouble, right? But wisdom is the principal thing, because that's the ability to apply what you know to its highest level, see? And all wisdom and understanding, knowledge comes from Yah. First 9 chapters of Proverbs. And if you don't have, and you can have all the money, per se, it can be bequeathed to you, handed down, as we know that's happened to many people, and many people who, large amounts of, economics has been handed down to them. They didn't have any wisdom or understanding, and they became impoverished. History is replete with situations of that nature. I mean, just here, a couple of weeks ago, I don't even think it's been a couple of weeks, Benjamin the Rothschild, 57 years old, died. A supposed heart attack. Okay? One of the Rothschild heirs. It was running this, banking situation, one of these big banks and banking, a conglomerate. Benjamin de Rothschild, 57 years old, as the article said, died of a heart attack. So, he had to be void of wisdom and understanding, dead at 57. And I mean, it wasn't any problem about economics. He had plenty of that from his inception. See, because economics is just a tool to be used. And if one does not have wisdom and understanding, they won't be able to use the vast amount of economics they might attain, okay? You follow what I'm saying? To its, best usage, to its highest level of usage. And we can see what Yah said he was going to do to the whole nation of Esau. We're going to take all the wisdom and understanding out of them. And how much more does that apply to those descendants of Esau who are in direct, confrontation, conflict with Yah? Like the Rothschild, Warburg, Schiff's, and so on. Okay? So, again, we're living in this time of destruction, total destruction of this fourth dominion of man. Again, of which the previous three dominions rest upon. So in other words, that image of Nebuchadnezzar as is depicted on the front of the flyer, as you see it, the Yah Righteousness flyer, the publication, is crumbling, right? Being decimated. Because the stone hit for certainty back in September 2004, when the monarchies were sprinkled. Okay? And again, that's when Yah started to shape and mold them for the time to come. Yeshua chapter 41. And again, Yah's doing it all, not by power nor by might, but by his spirit. Because he's the spirit of all living. All living. That's why Yah is to be feared and obeyed explicitly. with no equivocation. And when one reads and studies this book of remembrance and prays to Yah for wisdom and understanding, and acclimates oneself, male, female, young or old, Hamite, Shemite, Yefite, Israelite, Edomite, whomever, when one actually submits and obeys the Father, the King, He who creates Yah of hosts, with all their heart and soul, then, you know, you will acquire Yah's mercy, because Yah is greatly merciful, long suffering. Exodus chapter 34, 6 and 7 verse. He's not going to wipe out all the Edomites. He's going to wipe out all the Amalekites, because the Amalekites are never going to turn to Yah in any shape, form, or fashion. They are adversarial to Yah until He totally wipes them out. But you'll have Edomites out of the other lines of Esau, you know, out of the seed of Edom, right? Who you're going to get some who are going to turn to Him with all their heart and soul. And He's going to allow their, you know, seed, eggs to transition over into His dominion. You know, that's again why here, Yah righteousness, we don't hate any Edomite. We understand them. Because in actuality, we don't hate anybody. We hate what people do when they do iniquitous, wicked, abhorrent things. Okay? Those kind of things vex me every day. Okay? The things that, you know, I see my people do, and I see, you know, people of other nationalities do, you know, on the news, or, you know, things that they perpetrate. You follow me? Like this pandemic. To destroy people, to, you know. But at the same time, I know that's from Yah. He moves the sword. You remember chapter 25, right? The sword is in Yah's hand. It's all things and everybody is, right? Again, Yah tries the heart. You remember 17th chapter. Because the heart is deceitful, right? Desperately wicked. Who can know it? Yah tries everybody's heart. That's why He purged out, you know, those who weren't totally committed and submitted to Him, you know, a few years ago. You know, back then, what, 2016? Purged them out. 2017, purged them out. There's going to be some more going to get purged because their heart is not totally committed and submitted to Yah. You cannot fool Yah. You cannot trick Yah. You cannot hide from Yah. No way. It's impossible. Can't be done. Everything is before Yah. There's nothing that Yah does not know. To infinity. Infinitum. So we look and see at all of the, you know, the chaos and confusion and disruption and corruption that's going on today. I mean, it's, you know, it's a plethora of things, constant. I mean, you know, where you get people that have some knowledge stealing from other people. You know, I know many of you heard about that Reddit GameStop situation, you know. You know, they manipulate these stocks, you know what I mean, investments and whatnot, ripping people off, stealing their monies from them, you know, and nobody goes to jail. And it's a constant now, been that way, you know. They'll create a law so they can steal from people, or they just, you know, turn a blind eye to the law. These you know, investment bankers and Wall Streeters and elitists, okay. I mean, it's pervasive, and this is what so many you know, of the youth sees today. And they, like, you know, they take off in the ways of, you know, corruption, death, and destruction. And you hate to see, you know, the youth taking off into this path, you know, of destruction. Okay? And you definitely see the descendants of Yisrael, the youth and the young ones, you know, the young adults, you know, destroying themselves in the ways that they conduct themselves and the things that they do. I mean, I saw it coming, you know, over 30 years ago, you know, with this rap, you know, genre, the things that they start allowing them to say, you know, and the thoughts they started to inculcate into their minds, you know, with the, you know, profane and perverse, you know, thoughts and you know, sayings, you know, lyrics and whatnot in this so-called music, if you want to call it that, okay? And they program, you know, all the things that they see in these video games, all the things they see on the screen, you know, the idiot box, right? TV, theaters, what have you, and things that they program the youth with. And then they come up, you know, with these, like I say, these video games. I never played a video game in my life that, you know what I'm saying? But I hear they've got all of these video games out here now where they, you know, got inculcated in the video game, enhanced and you know, carjackings and, you know, shooting and all this. And you see these youths of Israel perpetrating these things, destroying themselves, you know, and they think they can do evil and wickedness and iniquity to better their station, and it's total fool's gold, totally, you know. Because you got to get recompensed. Whatever you do, whether it's good or evil, you're going to get recompensed. I don't care who you are, who you think you are. And, you know, with a lot of these youth today, you know, their thing is, their mindset is, they don't care. You know, I'm saying that euphemistic because they use, you know, other terminology. They don't give a so-and-so, okay? And they say that, see, until it happens to them. You follow what I'm saying? And that little split second or seconds that they have, you know, once it happens, once they get recompensed, right? You know, like I said, the epitome of that is when I saw this movie, Menace to Society, years ago. Okay? You follow me? It's also, you know, epitomized in Boys in the Hood. But it's really epitomized in that movie, Menace to Society, you know, okay? Right at the end. And that's what I see continually is going on in the Israelite communities, but it's in other communities of other nationalities as well, you know? And, you know, I'm told that these young folks today, basically, not all, but many, too many, and one is too many, male or female, but it's, you know, it's pervasive in the youth and the young adults, and even some older adults of Israel, that they're just totally adverse to righteousness, adverse to things that are, you know, right and correct, adverse to peace, okay? And it's just a horrible thing to see, you know, and to hear about on a regular basis, and it's becoming more prevalent, it seems, as this fourth dominion of man sinks deeper and deeper into collapse and destruction. Because that's what we're witnessing. As I said about a year ago, you know, back in, what was that, like April? You got a lot of people who, you know, think that, you know, by taking the shot, okay, the quicker they take the shot, the quicker this will go back to being what it used to be, like it used to be before March of 2020. They don't realize it's never going to be that again, ever. Okay? The world as we knew it before March 2020 is never going to exist again. Okay? Just like those of you who witnessed, you know, what happened on the 6th of January in, you know, in D.C., have you seen what they put up? We were looking at it yesterday, Yada and myself, what they put up in D.C. And they were talking about it on Russia Today. And they showed pictures of it. They got razor wire. Okay, they got all kind of barriers now. They got like about three or four checkpoints you got to stop at and get checked when you go up into D.C. now around Capitol Hill, the White House. See, that's what that Alan Nerin was talking about that I mentioned, you know, last session on Democracy Now. He said, you know, D.C. as you knew it is over with. It's not going to be that again ever. And you can see why. Because again, the mob, you know, on the 6th of January was manipulated, you know, by the, you know, powers that be through Trump. Okay? Because nothing going to happen to Trump in regards to that, right? He manipulated the mob, right? The mob has no illumination, okay? But now from that, right, you got all these other barriers because they know it's more, you know, problems to come with the people. People are upset. People are angry. See, and when you get mad, you can't think straight. Again, the earth is in darkness and the people of the earth in gross darkness. Yeshaya chapter 60, right? Daniel chapter 12, it's a time of trouble never been since it's been a nation. See, because, you know, again, there are no jobs, no, you know, and the jobs are becoming less and less every day. And again, that's Yeshaya chapter 47, verse 15, here in this daughter of Babylon. Now they're taking, just giving out more and more free money, which again is just another form of taxation. And you see it through inflation and, you know, making the dollar, you know, making it have less buying power. And so, you know, the inflation is happening as I speak, and it's going to get worse. Okay, because they're just blowing the dollar out. See? But again, you know, those of us who are totally committed and submitted to Yah, who are plugged into Yah, gold and silver and dollars and euros and RMBs, Bitcoin, yes, then cryptocurrency, that's not our, you know, salvation. You know what I'm saying? Because basically we're poor, right? Our faith and trust is in Yah of hosts, the fountain of living waters, whose waters fail not. See, for those of us who are totally committed and submitted in compliance and obeying all his laws, statutes, orders, judgments, commandments, and precepts, he's our hope, he's our trust, he's our salvation. He's our deliverer. Yah righteousness, the King. See? And that's where we place our faith, trust, and hope, and confidence. Always, continuously. See? And here we are today. You know, he's constantly giving us more understanding. And hopefully wisdom, right? Where we're not, you know, to jumping off the deep end. You know what I'm saying? We're calm in the midst of all this chaos, corruption, degradation, murder, you know, lies and deception. But we focused in on Yah. He's our hope. He's our salvation. He's our trust. He's our rock. Okay? In whom we trust, the sure foundation, the tried cornerstone, his righteousness, the law, with the statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts. See? And we do all we can to keep our minds stayed on Yah, that he keeps us in perfect peace. And what does Yah say? Those of us who put our faith, trust, and confidence in him, that wait on him continually, we are not going to be ashamed. Right? Because like it says in Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7, alas, that day is great. It's even the time of Zion's trouble. But they're going to be saved out of it. And that's what we're waiting on, Yah host. Our salvation. Our hope, our trust, our confidence. And he's not going to disappoint us. I know that for a fact. So we're waiting for him to judge the descendants of Esau that are over in Jerusalem, in Israel, at this very day. You know, dropping bombs on Syria, dropping bombs on our brothers, the so-called Palestinians in the Gaza. Got 1,000 checkpoints over there, harassing, beating them down. Our brothers is in, sisters is in Dimona, Mizpeh, Arad. You know, again, they're there like y'all see it. He would have them there. He would refrain for them that he cut them not off, even though they haven't been about Yah yet. But many of them are going to come over to Yah. When the Jerusalem movement is brought back and set in the midst of its sisters, Ezekiel 16, to be a comfort unto them. So be strong, O Israel. Okay? Wherever you are, when you hear this, be strong. Turn to Yah again with all your heart and soul. Read that book of remembrance, the so-called Old Testament, King James Authorized Version, Genesis through Malachi, the book of remembrance, Malachi chapter 3, 15 to the 18th verse. That's the word of Yah. Do your best, pray to Yah, you understand, for wisdom and understanding, do your best to be prepared to get in total harmony with Yah. Okay? Start now, if you can. Because again, the Dimona movement, you know, Sodom and her daughters, Yah's not going to really start allowing them to understand until he returns on the head of his movement, his arm, the Jerusalem movement. And that's back in the chapter 41, Yeshaya. But all others out there, wherever you are, you know, again, you know, read, study, pray, and do. And those of you who got ahead of Yah, who went to the land in front of Yah, trying to make up some reason why it was all right to get ahead of Yah, you're just putting more obstacles before you. Best thing I can say to you is humble yourself. Acknowledge your iniquity, whatever it is. Okay? Ask Yah's forgiveness, all right? Because you're going to have to make up your mind whether you're going to come over to Yah, our righteousness, the King, when Yah brings his arm, when he returns to Jerusalem on the head of his arm with the whole world watching, okay? Because the Jerusalem movement is Yah's righteousness. That's this book of remembrance. that's when, again, you know, it's prophecies that's been fulfilled. They can't be changed. Yah lifted himself up when, again, Yeshaya chapter 33, when the Edomites went in Lebanon and hewed it down. We've talked about this. That's when Yah lifted himself up through his holy name, through his arm, through his movement, Yah righteousness. And that was back in July 2006. July, August. It is what it is, okay? You know, those of you who have gone to the land and the Edomites are running the land, you know, a people of a fierce kindness speaking, you understand, with a strange tongue, a stammering tongue, and a strange speech that you can't understand, you know, if you're there, if you've gone there and they're there, you got ahead of Yah, in front of Yah. Yah wasn't before you. And there's nothing that you can do now to change that. Okay, you made a wrong move. You made your move too soon for whatever reasons. Okay, more likely than not, I know some running from something that they did that got out of harmony with Yah. So the best thing I can say to you is acknowledge your iniquity and pray to Yah for forgiveness. Yah is very merciful. Okay, but you got out of order. See, and if you keep running from Yah and refuse to acknowledge your iniquity, then you will be recompensed by Yah righteousness to King. I mean, we've got examples of those who got ahead of Yah and refused to acknowledge, like Saul, like Asa, like Uzzah. And it's others, right? Like I said here the other month, right, about Yaakov a few months back, last year, right? Yaakov had to acknowledge, you know, and he did that between the birth of Lewi and before the inception of Yahudah. That's why Yahudah was named Yahudah by Leah. Because now Yaakov acknowledged that these things that had been befallen him was his own fault because of him lying and deceiving his father and then going against the law of Yah, which he knew by taking two sibling sisters to wife. See? But he acknowledged it. And when he did that, then Yah had mercy on him. Again, and then he looked at Leah for all what she was, and that's all she ever wanted, okay? Because she is in harmony with the law. She got in harmony with the law of Yah through Yaakov. She learned it. And then finally, after, you understand, before the inception of Yahudah, he acknowledged to her, he acknowledged to Yah, he acknowledged to her and Raquel, he acknowledged to himself. And then he could see Leah for what she truly was. And then he really embraced her. And that's why when she became impregnated by Yah, you know, impregnated her with this fourth son, then she named him Yahudah. Yah be praised. He who creates be praised. Because now I'm finally embraced by my husband. He truly care about me now. See, that's understanding. This is what Yah has allowed us to see these last few years. See, as I was saying, you know, to Yada you know, I think I said it to Yadita here the other day, you know, we weren't ready. In 2016 to 2018, we weren't ready. Okay? Because again, when you listen to, as I have over the years, to all these different economists and bankers and whatnot, you know, those who fool with the stocks and, you know, all these different economies, they all thought that this was going to collapse after 2008. In 2009, they thought the collapse was coming, the economic collapse. But it didn't. See, because the Illuminists kicked the can. They kept kicking the can down the road, extending it. Financing this thing out of their own pocket. That's how I look at it. See, but that was from the spirit of Yah, because the Jerusalem movement wasn't ready yet. Look how much illumination Yah has brought from 2008 to now. Look the illumination that he's brought from 2016 to now. See, so again, you know, that's why, you know, Yah put in there, you know, I ain't forgot about you, Jerusalem, which indicates that we thought we were going to leave out at a certain time, but it didn't happen. That's what makes us say, boy, Yah done forgot about Zion, Jerusalem. Yeah, I forgot about you. But I got to purge out those with the hidden agendas, those with, you understand, picking and choosing of what they're going to do of my way, those who don't have enough faith in me. Because it can't be any that make up the arm of Yah, that return with him part of his arm, that equivocates, that's not solid with Yah, in total submission and commitment and compliance and obedience to his will. Can't be any that return to Yah that are emotionally inclined and allow emotions to dictate their actions. See, as I said a few months back, right? We got to learn, you understand, always to go to Yah, right? Whenever that fear hits you, whatever kind of fear it is, right? People do generally one or two things. They either run or they lash out. We had to learn and have had to learn and are learning, I'm, you know, certain, we run to Yah. That's why he said in Ezekiel, he's a little sanctuary unto us, wherever we are. Like he says in Jeremiah 29, you know, he said it to our forefathers back when he sent them to Babylon, you know, the original Babylon, right? You know what I'm saying? Of Nebuchadnezzar, right? He said, you seek the peace of the city. And again, that applies, that's applicable to this very day. Wherever Israel is, we are to seek the peace of that habitation. And what does it say? And pray to Yah for it. But in praying to Yah, as I said earlier today, you have to be in harmony with Yah. You have to commit and submit to his will with all your heart and soul. See, those are the prayers that Yah, you know, he definitely hears. Even when you ain't totally committed, he can hear it. But again, if you're only 10% in harmony with Yah, that's what you'll get back from him. If you're 50% in harmony with Yah, that's what you get back with him. So if you're 100% in harmony with Yah, that's what you get back. See, and that has to be worked on to purge oneself of the aberrations, inclusions, and defects. As we are his precious jewels, right? That again, we're like going to be like stones in the crown, the ones he brings with him on his return to Jerusalem. The holy diadem in Yah's hand, right? Shai chapter 62, like stones in the crown, right? And those stones had to be prepared. They had to be polished. They had to be cut and prepared to go in the diadem of Yah, right? To be, you know, removed, relieved of the inclusions and defects and aberrations. Yah being the ultimate jeweler. Because we've been under attack a long time. Like I said, you know, Bertrand Russell back in 1900, CEAD, what did he say? 3 to 4 years after the Illuminists saw, the seal was taken off the book, the 2 days, 2,000 years ended, the 2,500 years ended, the 2,000 years and the 2,500 years ended at the same time, 1896. Right, the 2,500 years and the first vision Daniel got, 11:36 to 12:10 Daniel. Right, when Gabriel standing on the water said it's a time and a half. Right? Then the seal, what he's saying, then the seal will come off the book. 2,000 years from when Yah totally wiped the sins of Israel's minds clean of who we are, who we were, where we come from, who he is. See, both of those two dates end at the same time, 1896. That's when the seal came off the book. See, now Yah was sitting there waiting to see of Israel who was going to search him out. Who refused to be misdirected, deterred. See, who really seeking peace? Who really seeking truth? Who's really seeking righteousness, equity? Who's really seeking salvation out of this demonic, satanic, oppressive, racist, horrible, corrupt dominion of man, which is the dominion of iron? Who really wants out from this? Who really wants to bring it to an end? Totally. See? Who really desires peace, truth, righteousness, equity, salvation? Who's really looking for the true and living Creator? And then, who's going to stay the course with a total commitment and submission to the Creator? Compliance. See? What does Yah say in 42nd chapter of Yeshaya? For a long time I've held my peace. Huh? Now I'm going to come out like a wailing, travailing woman at once. And this is what we see. He's stirring up jealousy. Huh? What did y'all say? I'm going to stir up jealousy like a man of war. That's why you see the Bezoses, right? You know, worth billions and billions of dollars and squeezing their employees. Look at the democracy now this morning. Pay particular attention to the last 10, 15 minutes of it. Because I got to watch it again. I caught the last about 7 to 8 minutes. Listen to what that Edomite on there talking with Amy Goodman, what he says about Bezos. Okay? Nothing that we haven't said here before. These super, super billionaires, right? And how they squeeze the few employees that they've got out of nickels and dimes. You know what I mean? What sense does that make? But that's the greed, right? The incessant greed that not only they have, but many people have. You know? Like the wanton acts, the insensitive, you know, maniacal acts that we see young Israelites, you know, commit. Vehicle hijackings. For what purpose? Okay, hijack 2, 3, 4 vehicles in the space of a couple of hours. Hijack one, get out, hijack another, leave that one there, get out and hijack another, then hijack another. You know, what sense does that make? You know, makes no sense at all. And in the process might hurt somebody seriously or kill somebody that they've got to answer for. All of these maniacal acts that they commit. Males and females. You know? You get the different, you know, Europeans, Caucasians, Gentiles, you know, descendants of Japheth, from what we can see, doing the maniacal things they do. Mass murders or whatever. Okay? Senseless crimes. You know, many of them, Israelites, Hamites, Shemites, steeped in drug activity, destroying their physical and mental and spiritual self. So Yah has moved the sword with the pandemic. Come and get your shot, right? And we'll take you out with the shot. Don't mean you'll die right immediately. You know, like Hank Aaron, he took the shot, He said he wanted to show Israelites that it was not going to harm them, it was going to help them. Hang Aaron died 18 days later. And this was the shot that took him out. So what he wanted, you understand, it didn't happen the way he thought it was going to happen. But what he did is helping Israelites to see, stay away from taking the shot. Okay? You understand? The agent, you understand, Jesse Jackson, that works for the powers that be, been working for him from day one. He took the shot here a few weeks ago. He went in the hospital here the other day. They didn't disclose what for, though. So, you know, we said last session, stay away from that shot. Shot is not conducive for us. Not conducive for humans. And those, again, go to the TED Talks. Because as Yosha told me, I asked him, what's that TED stand? He said, technological, educational, what does he say, design or something? The TED Talks, you know, a few years ago. And you see Bill Gates, if they haven't taken it down. And Yosha looked at more than I did. I just looked at a little bit. You understand? But he said, you know, you got to get an invitation to go to those talks. That's for the elite. And again, I saw another where Bill Gates talking about they're going to bring down the population by 15% in the world, huh? Through technology, through, you know, virus shots. Okay, that's what he's saying. I mean, you know, I'm telling you, they blatant. Because they look at it, you know, that's you know, nobody can stop them. But Yah, you know, this is all from Yah, moving the sword. See? So, you know, it's a lot of things going on. So don't.